Are we ready? Okay, thank you. I'm showing you this book, The Numerical Simulation of Unsteady Flow and Turbulent Transition to Turbulence. This was, as you can see, it's a proceeding of a European conference on something workshop at the Lausanne, Switzerland in 1990. So it's about 3 years ago. But you see, you take a little auditing, author correcting, and so forth. So finally, it's become available. And of course, by commercial mail, come to me, and I send my money over, and finally come. I bought three books, but the second book is here. Chaos in the Dynamic System. I thought maybe there is a turbulent in there, but it's not much turbulent in there. So if you are interested, you're welcome to borrow it. The third book I order is a direct numerical simulation. There is a book on the direct numerical simulations. They say that has not out of print yet, has not completed the printing yet, but I already ordered. So when it's come, probably semester is over, so I can show you. But anyway, if you are interested in that one, certainly you're welcome. Today's ME seminar, everybody attend. There's a large AD simulation there from University of Illinois the Computer Center. Because I was an interview chairman for civil engineering, so I couldn't come to the seminar too. But I hope you get something out of it. He and I did talk a little bit, use the simulation there. Okay, the reason I give you this article is that because we talk so much about the turbulence modeling, and maybe I can show you. I give you the cover page and some of the content there so you can look at it. This conference, I think, has three test cases. Okay, one is a S-shaped channel, like that. And they measure the turbulent boundary layer and ask everybody to go and predict and see if you can hit the right. And so that's one case. The case I gave you, I sort of remember I said that it's a very challenge to have a turbulent common vortex shedding compute. They are not exactly calculating that one, but it's coming a little bit closer. They have a channel with a cylinder, not right at the center, kind of just a little bit off from the plate. You probably can see like that. Okay, it's a channel flow. Anyone? Which?
Yeah, two of them.
Oh, okay, all right.
He needs the big one.
He got it.
Got everything? Okay. I don't know whether or not there's a data. Probably data can be taken because essentially just a wind tunnel with a rod there, and you can see the oscillation there. They are asking. Many people, I remember some time ago, I was invited to see if I want to submit some calculations to this conference, but we didn't have time to do it, so we didn't do it. So they asked many authors that the group working on the prediction terminal computation, say, please go ahead and calculate a flow like this and let's compare. And I think out of maybe about 10 people attempted this calculation, I thought the two bring the Reynolds number up enough for you to see the first author using a finite element, and you can see his calculations is up to Reynolds number of 10,000. And he indicates it's using a K-epsilon model. Okay? So I kind of want to update what I said in the previous class. There's a common vortex shedding is a difficult computer. It's still difficult, but anyway, there are some attempt now try to do it, and you can see some of the result. They will be able to predict the fluctuation in there, and some of the string line in there. This is the Reynolds number of 600 here. 1200 here.
Kind of,
oh, that's a 1200, yeah. This is a 1200, that's 600. So right now 600 we can routinely do it. Even 1200 we think can do it. They ought to put in the, let me see if, yeah. This is the one, Reynolds number 10,000. And I hope they're using a the K-epsilon model as they promise to do it. is that calculation. Okay, so that is the one author. And another author, yes?
Would that they look in the boundary condition, the outlet boundary condition?
Just this morning, I take a quick look at it. You're looking at the, they obviously have a periodic. You see, it's a channel here. There is a the pipe here, another pipe here, another pipe here. So they take it as a periodic. You see, that's the way you get out of a downstream condition because you can use a periodic condition. So you did see that in the plot, they do have a little bit cylinder there, and that certainly is going to affect all the shading there, but they seems to be able to get shading like this, shading a little bit larger, and even larger as the Reynolds number increase, so it's a fluctuate more. Yes?
It's not a periodic domain, though.
They start
upstream of the one cylinder, and then they end in the middle of another one.
Yeah.
Unless they're setting their outlet boundary equal to the
what they can get from this one.
Yeah, but that's tricky.
I haven't read the detail. Remember one of our students, Dr. Ong, we took it a couple of periods.
Mm-hmm.
And when you plot that, you plot what you want to see.
Oh,
So this may not be necessary because this essentially looks like about here. You see, you're looking at this part is almost like that part. So it's already repeated.
All right.
In that.
That's not necessarily a computational
right. And then that was a calculation made. Just let's get acquainted with who is doing it. This is from EDF, this Electricité de France. So it's that is the organization sponsor our September conference also. This was in the Chateau. Chateau is outskirts of Paris, I guess. Yeah. And the second group did it. Let's take a look who is doing it. This is also France. Also the Chateau group, EDF group. Okay, so obviously two groups is doing it in there. You can see now it looks very familiar to you, K epsilons, all the constant being used looks very familiar. And all the forms, P, production term, diffusion term, although the pressure strain term C1, C2, she looks very familiar to you. The constant they use, all of this one in here. And let's see, the one they calculate, I want to show you here. The reason I want to show this paper, they calculate 10,000 with K epsilon and another 10,000 with Reynolds stress model, okay? And but I'm disappointed with the amount of the result they show, only show stream functions. And that is all we got. We don't have, and also the stream functions. And maybe some lift they are looking at. So I kind of just let you, and the very last one is another author. Yes?
I'm just looking at the stream functions for Reynolds number, or the stream lines for Reynolds number 600.
Uh-huh.
I'm trying to figure out how they got the stream function to cross itself.
Yeah. it probably will be a zero stream functions. And inside there, you are looking at the Ken Carlson's question is that probably you are looking at this cross. This should be separated just like this, you see.
It's coming like this.
Yeah. Yeah, and then the inside will be negative rotation. Outside will be rotating, inside will be this. So there will be a cross loop there, just like a zone of a separation somewhere. I kind of want them to show that if they calculate using a turbulence model, how the Reynolds stress looks like, and if there is any measurement, let's go and compare. But anyway, I just kind of want to bring update to you that the turbulence modeling has progressed to this kind of a stage. If you want to have a quick look of what kind of a S-shaped channel they are doing, let me kind of quickly show you the geometry of the S-shaped channel. This is the first test case. They put it a wind tunnel with a intentionally make it a S. So the flow got to go through this, and then turbulent boundary layer gets skewed. Right? And then they went ahead and measured all kind of data, as you can see here. If you're interested in, then they give you all kind of a profile, Reynolds stress measurement, this one. And that become a test case for you to, each group to go and use your turbulence model, your computational method to see if you can handle it. Okay, so that's actually the International Symposium on Refined Flow Modeling started that way in 1981 when we had participated is that the IAHR, International Association of Hydraulic Research, said that there's too many computer code available, too many numerical methods available, too many computer prediction turbulence model available. Who is right, who is wrong, we don't know. So let's all get together and calculate the same thing. So I think this is a kind of outburst of also this kind. So that is one case. The second case I pass out to you. The third case is a transition. Let me kind of just quickly show you here. Maybe you see the diagram in the friction curves and you come down here and jump like that. You remember in the friction coefficients with the versus Reynolds number. So they are trying to predict the transition. Okay, that is another very difficult area. And that is only incompressible. If Mr. King is interested with the transonic transition or a hypersonic transition, it's even tougher. Right? So, but anyway, I think for our class, I ought to kind of bring you update what is going on outside. I want to pass on to you. Any comment or anything on that? Okay, that is just kind of a little bit update of our turbulence predictions. Okay, this thick handout is what I intended because we have only this week left, and after the class, I'd like to collect all your paper presentation sheet, and so I can summarize next Thursday. I assign who go first and who go on what day. With all the material I hand out initially at the semester, the more I look at it, the more I'm happy with it because it's so messy. And as far for the teaching use, you don't get a very clear picture of what is going on. You know, soon you'll be all drowned in all just a symbol, and you forget what you are really looking for. So I search and search, and I went back and dig all my file and find out this is a book edit, they call Phenomena of Fluid Motions. And there is an article by R.S. Brocky. Brocky, I think, is a chemical engineering professor at Ohio State. I remember he and I, one time we went to lunch together, we have a little talk. He also come to Iowa. Yeah, I think I sponsored him to come to Iowa to give a seminar a long time ago, one time. So, but I haven't seen him for a long, long time. But after I look at this article, I thought maybe go through this one and I will try to hit the major point for you so you remember at least the very basic of what the statistical turbulence is trying to do for us, all right? Rather than go through those all the mess here. So today I will go through the lecture that I had last time and then I will gradually phase into this. And since you can see from time to time in the page down in the bottom, there's a reference that I cut and paste and printed out for you. So should be relatively complete. If you want to dig out the reference to look at it, it will be fine. This page, eventually I will come to that one. I will talk about it. Okay, so before I lecture the statistical turbulence, I kind of want to say maybe three things. Three things you should kind of keep in the general picture of what we try to do. The first one, I will go over review that one, is that certainly the statistical turbulence not many people using for predictions, because quickly you will find what you can predict, isotropic turbulence, homogeneous turbulence, that's about it. One inhomogeneous turbulence, shear flow, you are out of it. It's just too complicated, you cannot create. So there will be some kind of Heisenberg model, you hear that, the high order model you hear and there. But all of them is all tangled in the isotropic turbulence, homogeneous turbulence, which is not really so useful for an engineer when you just put a flat plate with something sticking out and all the thing you spend the whole semester, whole book studying it, and just wipe out. So I'm not terribly anxious to kind of talk about how the statistical turbulence you can use for prediction. So after all, what we want to do with this statistical turbulence, and to me, it's three things. Overall, we want to understand turbulence more, because turbulence modeling, we seem to get into kind of phenomenological. We are guessing this, doing that, shrinking the volume, correlation like this. But we don't seem to see how the exact the turbulence is manifesting itself, how they interact, how the large eddy and small eddy interact each other, and how the mechanism is transferring from the large eddy where contained, we keep claiming containing the turbulent kinetic energy, how it being transported or the convected down to the small eddy. So this is where statistical turbulence will help us to understand more. So essentially, the statistical turbulence will tell us or give us a tool to understand turbulence physically a little bit more. Okay. Now, in what way? So three ways. First, I already mentioned about it, is try to find the probability function at the given point. You have all the turbulence going on there. You just say, okay, just looking at the one point, what is the chance of me to find the velocity falls into certain range? So if I will be able to know the probability function, then that is my first step to understand how the turbulence is doing at one point. And as to how to find that probability function, we'll review that quickly. Second, if you just understand the one point, that don't tell you much the physics yet, because we already view the turbulence has an eddy, has some coherence. There are large eddy, there are small eddy. So obviously, if this point is fluctuating in a certain direction, if there is a large eddy go all like this, there certainly must have some distance that I'm correlated with other point. Okay? So if for example, my finger is a 5 point, if this is the eddy, I'm rotating this way, so you can see if this is rotating this way, this point will also have a tendency to rotate it. So how do I find how large the eddy, or the how large this coherent, or the kind of correlated, or the related motion? If the eddy is moving here, this is a random here, so if I'm looking at this point and at this point, then that will be totally uncorrelated. So then we'll be talking about not just probability function at one point, we'll be talking about the correlations of one point with other point, or the one point itself with a different time, because you see the eddy rotated over, goes over like this. So if you're looking at the one point and at the different time, they may still have a persist of a motion like this. So you know there is a time duration that the motion is still preferred in a certain direction. So then we'll be talking about Eulerian correlations, or I like to call it a space correlation because it's a different location, or the so-called Lagrangian correlation is how that particle persists in certain direction. So it's sort of like a time correlation. So we'll be looking at the correlation. Now, once we define how to do the correlation, it's going to be very messy, because you can correlate. You see, I can correlate. You are thinking that maybe I'm moving like this, but there is a component I want to do. If I'm doing this, I have an x component, but the other point, I don't want to take an x component velocity to correlate. I may want a y component velocity to correlate. So you are going to have all the messy, like a Reynolds stress correlation there. Yes?
Why wouldn't you want to take the same component?
You can take the same component, you can take a different component, you can take a different distance. And that's why last time we talked about the one-point correlation, two-point correlation, or two-location, two-time correlation. That will be the messy of all. And out of that one, you can say that I don't want correlation just to stay UU. I want the UV or UW. And I said, and then you would say that why only the second order correlation? Why don't we take a UU or UV and this is a W with a separate there? So you are going to see all the messy notation come. So you can see why the Hinge book or the Townsend book that I print all the notes for you is so messy. And of course, Dr. Brocky's note, he cannot get away with that one, but I thought his notation is a little bit more manageable. In a sense, so we'll be looking at that. So that is the second thing, the way we will be able to understand the turbulence. Okay, probability function at one point, we're looking at the correlations. Now after the correlation is done, for us how to use it. Okay, so here I have a bunch of correlation. So we got to reduce it to some number of the parameter we can play with. So we'll be talking about integral scale or some kind of a length scale. Okay, so sort of like a mixing lens or the molecular collision there. So we say, okay, is this correlated? How far they correlate? So we want to define some sort of a lens so we can think about it. Okay, so eventually in the note, actually, Dr. Brocky, very nice. He summarized all the definition and quickly he summarized, okay, these are all the correlations. These are the scale you can use and so forth. So I thought that note would be very good in that sense. Now, after that is done, I kind of want you to think, these two things is just like when you study inviscid flow. Instructor goes through the kinematic of all the motion, describe how the stream function, vorticity, all of that. But you got to look at the dynamic side of it, not just kinematic, how you describe all of this. So in order to look at the dynamic, that means from this eddy to that eddy, how they interact. Then you got to go to the equation of motions. So we'll be back to our Reynolds stress equation, which is second order. So we will put a correlation into that one, not necessarily one-point correlation that we derive for our turbulence model, can be two-point, 2.2 time if you want that, all right? So now how do we looking at that, those very messy distribution there, then here come the so-called spectral, because there is no way you can look at everything all together. So you are going to do the spectral and you hear the Fourier transform. So today, in the beginning of my part, I'm going to tell you how you think Fourier transform. Fourier finite transform, Fourier discrete transform, Fourier continuous transform, how you should think physically. Many of you gone through the intermediate mass or the some mathematical method for physics. You know all those transforms. You can go find table, plug in all of this. But when I was a graduate student, I was able to do that. But I have no physical idea what it really means to me. So now since I spent some time go went and figure it out, I thought I'd pass it on to you. So I will tell you how you think, build a Fourier transform, an inverse transform, or Fourier series, and the Fourier coefficient, how you should think about all of this. And then we'll put that one into the dynamics of statistical turbulence. So we'll be able to looking at the large eddy, how the large eddy with a wave spectrum. Large eddy means wave number is small, right? Small eddy, I mean the wave number is very high because you, in the 2 pi, you have so many waves in there, okay? So we'll be looking at the wave spectra. So we'll be eventually getting to the spectra, which we haven't really used it for the turbulence modeling. So that way we will understand the turbulence a little bit more physically, how they interact in terms of a single wave, okay? So if you understand this, then Of course, I will time to time will come back to review to you. Three things we try to get out from the statistical turbulent is probability functions, some sort of correlations, and follow with a length scale, and then we are using spectral analysis to study the dynamics of all the AD interactions. Okay? All right. Before I continue on, any comment or anything you want to say? I hope it's, the picture is clear to you. Okay, let's have a quick review. Of course, we are in the last part before the special topic of your presentation. We are on the statistical analysis of turbulence, and we want the statistical description of turbulence motions. And I already mentioned we are going to use the probability function, correlation, and the spectra to look at the turbulence. Okay, this is kind of by way of a review, and I show lots of turbulence here. We already know at any given instance, any velocity component would have a fluctuation in time or in space because it will be irregular in space, so you have it. So instead of looking at the instantaneous time, this is back in the, our very beginning introduction chapter that we used to have, just a statistical analysis of it. So the first part is just a very simple probability function. So instead of asking us to go and trace each instance how they behave, we will opt to statistical mean looking at the probability functions by asking that for this particular point of turbulent behavior, what is the chance for me to find the velocity would fall into this particular range of the velocity, because I have a delta u here, so this is delta u. So that means the b of u is the probability of finding my velocity at that velocity range. So for example, if I am up here, which essentially will be zero, because b of u will be zero, so that means at that point, my fluctuation or any instantaneous velocity never reach that velocity here, or even the lower here, I'll never have that lower velocity. So all the velocity will be frozen here. And so by definition, the integration of all the probability under this curve will be 1. Because under that curve, you 100% you will find somewhere it's there, right? So it's a definition of 1 there. Now, the problem of how do we generate from these data to get this probability function is in questions, okay? How do we get it? And because we will define, as we last time looked at it, the probability function of this velocity falls into this delta u essentially is a summation of all the time portion that you find the velocity falls into this range of velocity is the summing over here divided by the total time. This is just simple by definition. It's a fraction of the time I'll be able to find it there, so that is my probability, okay? So by using this definition, so now we can define whatever the property we want to take a time average of it here. So if the f is the average quantity of some sort of function you are looking at, then you time the probability function there, so of course, integrate this one will give you the all possible. So that is the way we define the moment or the average. So if that is the case, you're looking at one by one. Of course, the average velocity certainly is the instantaneous velocity times the probability function. Or if you replace the probability function by 1 over t and set that the time interval, well, actually du is small, so it becomes dt. So you can integrate them out. So it's very simple. Instantaneous velocity integrate over the time period of the measurement give you the average velocity. Now what we are doing this, of course, for one thing we can use this average velocity. We like to have it as an engineer so we know the kind of long time average is that. But in terms of a probability function for the statistical use, that is a starter we call mean there. And then you go to the square of instantaneous velocity, of course you get a kind of an energy, kinetic energy. You go to the Q, you go to the triple moment or the third moment, you go to the fourth power of that one. So you can see instantaneous velocity, if you integrate or square it or triple it or make a fourth power out of it, you can find this. But from that one, now you can look at your probability function is a kernel inside the integration. So only just one of those, you cannot get the very precise probability functions. So the inversion of a kernel, you need as many as moment you can. So you can see the physicists at an earlier time measured the average velocity variant, skewness, flatness, just keep going on, and what they are doing, they try to invert it to find the probability function for that point behavior. Then you understand what the turbulent is about. And last time we looked at that, some sort of a fluctuation will produce a different kind of a probability function. Okay? Yes?
What's the distinction between U and U star there? U star is the instantaneous velocity, right?
Yes.
Right. Integral of U.
I agree. You can put all the star here, if you like. Yeah, probably to be consistent, yeah, there should be all star. That any instantaneous velocity, you integrate with the probability function. Okay, and I don't want to go to the two-dimensional too much. Last time we already see that is only one-dimensional probability function. Now, if you say that the probability of finding my turbulent at this point has a U fold in this way, W in that way, then you have a joint, the so-called joint correlations you got to looking at. And you have a U fluctuation in this side, V fluctuation in this side, and now the domain of a probability function is no longer just curve, it's a contour now. So if you're looking at this, or you may want to look at the contour, looks like that. Okay? So it's just a generalization of one dimension to two dimension. So that is a correlation. Okay. So that finish up that part now. Now, as I said, those correlations or those probability function is looking at that particular point, right? And if you're looking at this picture, we have used this before with the visualization of boundary layer fluctuations. I'm interested not only at this point's fluctuation, but I want to know this point, while this point is behaving in such a way, how this point is doing it. So that just like now, maybe tonight I go home, when I'm eating my supper, I call Joseph, what are you doing? Are you eating too? So okay, so now I know I'm correlated. I want to know what you are doing while I'm doing such a thing. So if we both of us are eating, then I know we are correlated. Maybe time is right and so forth. So we want to know that. Now the reason we want to know that, if I want to call you what you are doing, well, are you sleeping, are you doing homework? Must be is an advisor checking the student, do a good job or not. But anyway, it's kind of social correlation you are looking at. Now, if I want to know if this point is doing this fluctuation, I want to know this fluctuation, obviously, I want to understand the fluid turbulent behavior, not the social behavior, there's the fluid behavior there. So, if I find the correlation, then fine. Then I understand what is going on here. Okay, so the same thing here, just like a jet coming from a pipe. I want to know now if this and that has any correlation. You can see if this and that correlation, it begin to tell me this area of the behavior seems to be coherent because seems to have an eddy rotating there. If I'm asking this point versus the point up here, it may not correlate because if I'm rotating this, that can rotate in this or rotating whichever the way you want to go. Yes?
What exactly qualifies them as being correlated? Because like if in the picture you've got there, those two points, if they're within 180, one may be moving up and the other may be moving down.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you able to discern that those two are correlated any more than...
Okay, so we have to define the correlation. Correlation, after all, is either time average or the ensemble average. So if this point tend, all of this fluid nearby here tend to rotate together. So they have a more coherent, if I'm on the positive rotation, you, the next point will be also positive rotation. So if I take a long time average, they will be correlated because they're all positive, positive.
Correlated by rotation and not velocity.
Or velocity, yeah. Yeah, well, rotation is a part of velocity too. So I can, for example, I'm looking at U velocity. If this is the U moving down, then I know they are correlated. All right. But however, if you're looking at this point versus this point, while this is a positive clockwise rotation, the other one maybe at some instance clockwise, some another instance counterclockwise. So in a long-term average, it will just kill you. Just you get no correlation. Then you know it; they are not related. All right. So in that sense, you can study how the turbulent behave. So the correlation useful in that sense, you'll be able to see the correlation. Okay. And as an example, if you're looking at the building here, I think the if I'm an architecture or I'm going to invest someone to avoid a lawsuit of somebody living down there, I'm going to demand. The architect, you design, actually I hate our Florida educational building, that the tallest, the white, kind of funny looking building, and every day I drive there, I'm not terribly happy because I'm more aerodynamic man, and looking at that, why, what in the world the architect would design such a sharp corner, and when the flow goes over, it is going to trigger all kind of vortex shedding, or the curling up. Why don't we be a little bit more smoother, all right? And for example, if you have a very large eddy, if someone is going to stand, has an apartment house there, he has a veranda, not to mean have a balcony, he may just, when gas comes, just all the large eddies is going to sweep him over. So the design firm got to looking at this, and that is why, I don't know, you heard of Colorado State Civil Engineering Department in the 80s has a so-called wind engineering program, and there is a huge wind tunnel there, and all they are doing is all environment study, cooling tower. Okay, all the tall building, television tower, any kind of structure they want to study, city power plant locations, because you see the power plant, the prune is polluted, and they want to make sure that the prune will not fall to the urban area, so got to be far away. So all kind of study there. They have a huge wind tunnel, and is led by Professor Selmack. And he makes so much money, he went out, established his company, established his wind tunnel, and I think he has a wind engineering company now, so he quit the school, okay? So you can see the wind engineering, lots of things. You see, let me give you an example of cooling tower. Many, Europe has a lot of, particularly France has a lot of cooling tower. Cooling tower is a hyperbolic shape going up like this, because hyperbolic shapes in some way it's a fluid draft. There is some theory that would be best drafting. You can pull the cooling water down and the air up, and so you can cool the power plant, the water. You know the power plant cycle, you got to cool, and so go back to high temperature and so on. Now the cooling tower, you go and visit the cooling tower very closely. If you drive by any power plant, look very carefully. Cooling tower, that the cement, that the tend to be cement about that thick, fairly thin cement in there because it's very high. You're looking at the surface. Surface is intentionally roughened. Okay? Why? If you make it smooth, when the gas wind come here, the pressure created by the kind of laminar flow over it. You know the cylinder, when you go through here, the pressure at the top here, let's say, I don't have a, let's have a cylinder. Sorry. If this is a cooling tower, let me put it up right here, and the flow comes over here, and the cooling tower is, well, let's say just a straight cylinder here. You know the stagnation point here, pressure will be high. On the two sides, pressure will be very low. All right? So if a wind, the faster the wind, the difference in the pressure will be higher. They have some collapse in the cooling tower because they didn't design it right. They want to save the material, make it thin, but they didn't realize that the compression stress they think it can withstand, but they never realize that the wind just blow, and this lower pressure, this whole cooling tower just collapse, just drop. So try to fix it to save your material. You can make it very thick, but you still have that lots of wind power. So what they do is they roughen, create a turbulent. So all the pressure distribution will become a little bit different. So go and look at it. Now, that is one problem we engineer you can study. Another problem is that the cooling tower, they want to come in a bundle. Several cooling towers tend to be 2 or 6 or 4 all lined up together. When they line up together, the cooling plume goes out there, they will entrain each other. So you got to make a wind engineer study how far they got to separate in this particular terrain where the wind normally is dominant from one direction. So you want to line up a cooling tower in certain way with your preference of wind comes in. So lots of study you can do. Iowa also did something on that. Okay, so you can see that all the turbulent, all of this flow visualization, the correlations is all very important. Just mention the cooling tower for one. Okay, so now with all of this correlation necessity that we have to have. So last time we talked about the general correlation, and the general correlation is that using Rij for a correlation of I component and J component, by definition is right now we are referring as a velocity. It you probably can using S or W or something to refer to the one pressure, one velocity if you like. You can study all kind of different correlation if you wish. But this will be the most basic one is a two velocity correlation, I component at the X and the time, T. And the J at the X plus a distance away and the time plus another time later. So it's a two time, two location, and two velocity component. One may be I component, one may be J component as a general, right? And of course, we talk about most of us are more familiar with the 1 point, one time correlation because we use the turbulence model that for the simplicity. But you may have a 2 point correlation at the one time, so at the two different locations but the same time. And or the 2 point correlations at the same location but the different time. Okay, so you can do that. So with all of this defined, now we know that we have a correlation. But how do you study the correlations? Okay, and this come to this page now. Seems like I got to lower it. Okay, so I want, before I get into the detail of all those correlations or the dynamics motion of that one, I kind of want to take time out to tell you a little bit of mathematics. And once you have this physical understanding of this mathematics to you, I think you look at the things, at least to me when I was studying it, once I realized this, looking at all those messy notation, I don't care. I may miss some subscript of that one, but I seem to be able to keep myself very clear each equation progress, how they are doing. I know, okay, they shift the spectral domain, they shift the back, they integrate this wavelength, so become one dimension. So I kind of keep myself very clear of what it's doing. Okay, so let's kind of looking at the so-called correlation and spectra or the spectrum, okay? And try to make you understand how the correlation and the spectra are related. Of course, I can say, yeah, correlation is every all the wavelengths in there, spectra is take one wave at a time. But how we do it mathematically, okay? And so that is what is coming. Suppose F is some sort of correlation, okay? F of X. whatever the function mathematically you have supposes this. This can be space correlation, time correlation, or even probability function. You know, whatever the shape you get, you say, okay, now I'm going to consider this as a function. And to expand in the Fourier series, for simplicity, I just normalize it minus pi to pi. You can minus 1 to 1 or minus L to positive L if you like. Okay? Now, you know it from your study of some mathematics, you can represent this function by Fourier series. Okay? And I keep this series in symmetric and anti-symmetric as a sine and cosine series as a, in general there. And I will assume most of you how to find this coefficient a, k, and b, k if f of x is provided. Okay, what you do is time one mode of either cosine or sine on both sides and integrate, right? So you get Fourier coefficients like this, right? And everyone knows that, probably even the undergraduate, you have seen it here. Now, So what does this mean? Up to now, maybe you think that, okay, there is a function, there is a Fourier coefficient, is all we know it. But I kind of want you to think, let's examine the physics a little bit more. If this is a function such as looks like this, if my AK, particular K, let's say K is 10, and of course I associate with cosine 10x here. If AK is very large, it tells me what? This particular cosine 10x shape is dominant or has made the largest contribution to this shape. Of course, this shape is not just a cosine or sine. It's a composition of many waves you added on, right? So for example, if I have only cosine here, then everything will be zero, and only that particular cosine k will be there. And if a k is 10, is my curve, then the k is 11 is out, k is 9, everything is out, only one, right? So you can see, if a curve is a sine or cosine, you only need one coefficient. If a curve is not sine or cosine, a composition of a several. If it is a, this curve is a combining of a sine x plus sine 2x, and all the rest is zero, then you know that all those coefficients will disappear other than the coefficient which is a sine x and sine 2x will remain. So you should think these Fourier coefficients tell you physically how important this particular k, or this particular sine wave, is to this curve. Okay? And so now, by doing this one, and now you have an infinite many, and you can compare any one of them. And for example, if I take this curve and using a Fourier series fitted, for example, my ak and the bk here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, you can see maybe my k is 3, is very large. The k 5, 6 is that, and beyond that one maybe 0. You can see my bk, maybe the 1 is large, and as I go to larger k, it will disappear. So it will tell you, if you think now this k, because k, now many of you will be able to think k is like a wave number, wave number, okay? And wave number, what is the wave number? You can think within the 2 pi, how many waves I have in between. So the larger the k, the larger the wave. Certainly you can see if I draw a cosine 1 like this, cosine 2 will be just a sine, will be like that. So sine 100, then I have a lot of oscillation there. So you can see if this curve has anything to do with the turbulent eddy or the correlation in the distance you are going, and you said, okay, with this correlation, which particular wave, which particular eddy size is contributing to my this correlation? Then you're looking for that particular k is large. So if this is a kind of discrete Fourier series, this is a Fourier series like this, you can see all this coefficient, which physically tell you which wave number is important. The larger the coefficients, the larger that wave is going to contribute to your curve. Okay? And I think you probably, some of you probably already know it. Now, why I say this is important is that you are on this side, you are looking, looks like a discrete, adding 1, 2, 3, because k is one integer, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a discrete representation of this curve by adding, because you make it discrete, only k is 1, 2. You don't talk about k is 1.222 or 1.416, so forth. So its k's variation is not continuous. However, in our turbulent analysis of an eddy size, there are no, turbulent is not going to just give you such a nice integer number. Either this wave is 10, and then the next one is 9, next one is 8. They are going to continuously change it. So for us, looking at the correlations using a Fourier series is a discrete. And the turbulent never behaved like a discrete, so you got to go to continuous. And that is where I thought that this will give you some good idea of looking at it. So I want you to look at some correlation now of this. On the other hand, we'll be talking about spectrum. Now, all of a sudden, many of the turbulent book is going to give you, okay, correlation looks like this, and the spectra looks like this. And all of a sudden, you look at it and say, gee, I lost. Why all of a sudden, one side is this, one side is that? Okay? Now, I kind of want you to look at it. If you change this coefficient, okay, looking at the sine, cosine sine over here, you can looking at that, see if I can make it a little bit more clear. Just looking at some, I call it a continuous functions, this function here, integrate that one, it looks b of u here, it looks like my f of x here, right? And so if I'm looking at this b of u is like a f of x, then you see my this side, b of u, she looks like a f of x. And of course, I'm using a complex notation of iku here. And you know the complex notation you expanded out looks like this, I sine and cosine. So essentially, I'm looking at the sine and the cosine all together. One I put in the imaginary, one I put in the real. So you can see this essentially is my, if you wish, in this discrete sense, this is the Fourier coefficients of A and B all put together. The imaginary part go to sine part of it, and the real part go to cosine part of it here. So it looks like A and B putting together in this side, okay? And now on this side, on this side, F of function now is an integral because you see I have a continuous change of my wave number. So this essentially is a replacement of Fourier series. You see, this is a series in a discrete writing. All right? Let me see if I can kind of lower it here. You're looking at that, this is a discrete way you write a function like this. This is a continuous way of writing it. Okay? And then the Fourier coefficient here become a Fourier transform. So if you like, you can looking at the one side is a Fourier transform, the other side is a Fourier inverse transform. Okay? And so I kind of want you to think Fourier series to us is more comfortable because we know that the series represents this coefficient this way. So actually you can think this expression is a Fourier transform. Well, you think a Fourier series is a Fourier transform, Fourier coefficient is a Fourier inverse transform, if you wish. Okay, so from now on, I want you to feel comfortable. If I'm talking about a function which is a correlation, if I put that correlation into here, I'm making a Fourier inverse transform, I go to the spectrum. And now you know, this function, remember, is like A and B. So for a particular k, this function is large, then you know that particular wave dominates in my turbulent behavior. Okay? So that's why I give you a kind of a comparison here. One is a continuous function, Fourier transform, Fourier inverse. The discrete form, Fourier series, Fourier coefficient. Okay, so only the name change, actual meaning is between discrete and the non-discrete. If you understand that one, you can see now, we can, you probably today where I won't be able to get to that. You can just go and looking at the, take a Reynolds stress correlation we derive. Of course, we derive is a one-point correlation, there is no separation, but derive the Reynolds stress for 2 points. Point A for U, point B for V, and you put Fourier transform into it, and all the equations shift to the spectral domain. And if you pick up 1k at a time looking at it, so you are looking at that particular wave is doing what in my dynamic equation. All right? So that is eventually we'll be able to understand the different size, different term in the two-point Reynolds stress correlation is behaving. Okay? Now, I now turn to this one page I gave it to you. If on the left-hand side is an example of F, which is the correlations, all right? On the right-hand side is the spectra. Okay? Or if you like to looking at it, this is the Fourier transform, Fourier inverse transform. So that's a function and that's the spectrum. Okay, Fourier series, Fourier coefficient representation. Alright? Now you're looking at it, let's go and figure out for this kind of top half shape here, you can see the cosine will be 1, right? Cosine curve will be 1, and you can looking at the k here, of course 1 will be dominant, and you can see there are some negative number, and go up in here, this actually would represent the spectra of it here. You're looking at the triangle shape here, then everything remains positive, or like this. So the wave number in that locations don't make a lot of contribution, long wave make a good contribution. So is this. This is the k is small, so k small means a long wave. In 2 pi, you have a one wave, then of course you want. So of course you are looking at the phenomenon like this, all long wave, because this is long wave, that's a long wave, right? Now if I have a lot of a curve like that one, you can see it is going to dominate over the other larger wave number side of it. The last example is kind of a little bit funny. Two end there, they peak it here. So you can see they continue quite a bit here. You know how to have lots of a wave added out here to bring this one up is tough. So you need many, many combinations of different waves to make up this curve. Okay, so you feel comfortable now, we can talk about Fourier series, Fourier coefficient, Fourier transform, Fourier inverse transform. We can look at correlation, spectra, they're all same thing now. Okay, so for the rest of 15 minutes, I'll go over this quickly, and then Thursday we'll pick up maybe the dynamic side of it. Today we probably will still pretty much stay in the kinematic description of how this correlation works. So let's go on to the this note I just handed out from Phenomena of Fluid Motions. Is the FSU under the Library of Congress system? They have a QA, QC. They're using 517, 520, 320. That is that's a Dewey system. University of Iowa switched to Library of Congress system.
TA, TL, all that stuff.
Oh, you have that? Okay. Yeah, so if you want to see the whole book, go and find out the QA 911. This is not the 13. My writing is B69, okay? And it's published in 1967 by Edison Wesley. Yeah. And I took it up only chapter 14, and I cut and paste, only take the statistical theory of a turbulent flow, because that is where I want to talk about it. Yeah. And I'll let you go and read all of those. I'm not going to repeat it, that. Okay, since we are using his note, we got to get acquainted with his notation. So right away in your next page, the introduction to term and the definitions, we'll be talking about the homogeneous turbulent, isotropic turbulent. Homogeneous turbulent is independent of position, okay? And isotropic turbulent is independent of all directions, okay? So what's the difference? And I kind of draw my picture here to show you. Like in the channel flow, and remember we use this experiment to determine one of the turbulent coefficient there. You can see you have a constant shear here. So even you move this location to next location, or from the bottom up a little bit, maybe let me kind of amplify. Homogeneous in the sense, if you move from this point to another point, or from here up to another point, you can see it'll be all the same because they are all same gradient, same production, same kinetic energy in there. Don't misunderstand that. Well, in the bottom part here, the mean velocity is slower, so turbulent kinetic energy should be smaller. And here on the top, velocity is faster, so my turbulent kinetic energy should be larger. Remember, the generation of turbulent kinetic energy is relied on the production term, which is the gradient is a matter, not the absolute velocity you have there. So you see your measurement of a turbulent behavior will be homogeneous in most of this space, other than very, very close to the wall, because then the wall shear is going to come in. So that is a homogeneous-like kind of a turbulent. Now, the isotropic turbulent, that means that every direction will be the same. And obviously, if you take a measurement over this one, certainly the U fluctuation, V fluctuation, not necessarily the same. So homogeneous turbulent is not necessarily isotropic turbulent. Right? The isotropic turbulent certainly can qualify as a homogeneous turbulent. So what is a good example of isotropic turbulent? It's kind of wind tunnel screen grid turbulent. That means he's using a UX, which is the U1. The plane is the root mean square of this. So this in our notation is a U square. Take a square root of that, and he's using a prime. Prime to denote the root mean square. Already taking average and take a square root of it is his prime. Okay? Now in the isotropic turbulent, of course, U square, V square, W square should be the same, or the root mean square of U, V, W should be all the same. Otherwise, would not qualify as a isotropic turbulent. Okay, so that is his notations. The correlation, we already talked about it, but just to adapt his notations. We're using R, capital R. He dropped the X here, only denote this size R. So that means this is understand given at that X location, and they are separate by R distance. So I kind of want to show you this picture. Your picture is in your next page, but I cut and paste to put it into one. You can see there is a 2 point separate, or this point and this point separated by R distance, and that will come into play of this R here, right? So this, now as R, you can see at this point, if a fluctuation instantaneous is going like this, this goes like this, and right away physically you feel it. A large distance would have a low correlations. The short distance, of course, you have a high correlation. Now, of course, you have that physical feeling already. So right away you say, if this is small, certainly they are UU, you see? And if this is large, even the same U, you may be wondering doing some other things, okay? So that is the correlation you get there. Okay, Now, in terms of correlation, I already mentioned can correlate with the space and correlate with the time, and his notations is using Q. He liked using a Q instead of R because he reserved R for one-point correlations. So Q, the ij, is a velocity I and velocity j separated by t, and he ignored the time there. He called it the Birkhoff theory of some statistical thing that if you take a long time average, it will end up the same there. That I have some doubt that can apply to any turbulent. Maybe only the homogeneous and isotropic turbulent may be applicable. But in any events, let's look at the so-called correlation function, Eulerian correlation function. To me, many of you already know, Eulerian description, Lagrange description, Eulerian description is you're looking at everywhere, same time. So you, from Eulerian, you take a correlation, you'll be looking at the two different locations at the same time, right? So it's a, to me, is a spatial correlations. And the way they define it here is that they want this go to 1 at the maximum, because divide by u prime, remember that is the root mean square, I wrote it down here, of that, and the x plus r prime is also root mean square of that difference, okay, at the same location twice, okay? So this is a kind of a u squared take a square root, another u squared at a different location take a square root. The top side is a correlated one, okay? Top side is an instantaneous velocity correlated at the second. So if this r distance goes very far, you can see this is going to go down, okay? So you have a, maybe you see a curve, not exactly like this, but you certainly see a curve kind of tails off in there. Okay, now, that is a correlation he defined, and now if we're using his notations, Rijr here, you can see he is using sort of Cartesian tensor notations using R and J, so this will be the I component, this will be the J component. I hope this is the largest I can go in here. Okay, so why, okay. If this is the I, you can think this will be the I component, and if this is a J, can be a different component normal to this. But if I using a UR, this is UR plus R, then of course everybody is in the R direction, okay? So that is a what he called the axial direction. He using a un as a difference of r distance, but it's kind of normal or the orthogonal to the r direction there. Okay, and so he is going to using that correlation in the isotropic turbulent is going to denote as a fr, and the isotropic turbulent as a gr. Why is that? He said that without proof. I'm not good. Well, actually, if you like, you can kind of challenge yourself to see if the homework you can prove it. That in the general correlations, certainly is in this way. Okay. Now, when you have an isotropic turbulent, because isotropic is an independent direction, so that means this side of fluctuations and that of fluctuation at that given point should be the same, because u squared, v squared should be the same. So by doing that one, you can say that all of this is the independent direction, so rather than have a tensorial, you become a scalar, because everybody is the same thing. So this is a tensor, but if it is isotropic, you reduce it to scalar, called f of r. Okay, and then the g of r is the normal directions. So you see, you got to realize if I have a separation of a 2 point between, say, here and here, I have U fluctuation there with this distance, that correlation will be different from this correlation. You see, you say, if it is isotropic, why is it not different? I said, if you take this direction, then I got to take this distance. That correlation then will be the same as this correlation, because this is isotropic. But it's not necessary in the isotropic this way correlation and with the same distance separate, but in the different component this way is not necessarily the same. So that's why he said that if it is isotropic, and that has been proved by using a continuity equation, you can show this correlation G of R is equal to F of R plus this much. Okay? So what it's saying is this. This correlations and this correlations with the same distance here, this correlation is this correlation plus something else. That come from a continuity equation. All right? And they even went so far out to check experimentally. Just take an isotropic turbulent and actually make a correlation. Okay? And you can see there is a measurement here, and this using G is F plus R over 2 derivative of that one with respect to R. And you can see the data seems to be out. G of R, and you can measure the F, put it over this side, and calculate G. Or take an actual G measurement. Take this correlation measurement plot. Take this correlation measurement and add that function, and you can check out. Indeed, the isotropic check out very well. Okay, so that show you the correlation. Of course, Ken, you probably right away say, oh, I'm looking at some distance. So you can see there's a R distance here beyond like a 5 or so, then there will be no more correlation. And why is this 1, 2, 3, 4? Because this is a particular grid size you're looking at. I wish they probably normalize this one into dimensionless. Otherwise, later on, maybe let me show you this, the correlation on this picture. The two pages down there, you can see they normalize the correlation to 1, and this is the distance. You can see the correlation distance, they tell you, let me see if we can read this one. There is a 5-inch mesh screen. So, geez, this mesh screen is big, huh? A grid like this. And 5 inches, to me, each inch is about, what, 20, let's say around 25 millimeter. So 5 is 120 something, so I kind of take. So the mesh size is this. So that means all the flow goes through here. I kind of put another mesh here, distance or flow here. So you can see the flow goes through here. The largest eddy will be about this side. You can see the correlation beyond that one tails off. So you can see the flow pass through a screen of this side, the largest correlation. Because the next grid, the flow comes in here, not necessarily behave in the same way you want it. So you can see if I'm stand on the street and the wind blow past my body, I said my behind me has a lot of turbulence, the largest correlation will be probably my body size. Okay, and you can see this is probably true. I show you this. This is the kind of plate they dig a hole here. So this is a block. This is a solid block. So you don't have anything coming out here. You see, but you can see all of this coming out here once become a turbulent. Looking at eddy size, about that, or any kind of distance that you're looking at, that correlation will be almost about the separation side you got here. And that is equivalent to what you're looking at the screen here about separation of that one, the correlation distance probably go about that. Of course, this way has a tail end there, so later on, when the Thursday we meet, we'll define what is the integral scale. Essentially, we take take an integration under this area, we call it some sort of a length scale. And that has been used by the statistical people to look at, oh, my turbulence is this turbulence. Depending on what kind of correlation you perform, for example, you perform the triple correlation, then it will not correlate very well, because once you go out there, because the higher the correlation you go, the narrower it will correlate. So then you'll be able to see what kind of correlation behavior. And you can looking at the dissipation function, turbulent production function, convective term, diffusion term. Each one of them, you can put a correlation on it at a different 2 point and take a Fourier transform, then you can look at the spectrum. Okay, I'll stop here. It's 7:15. And I hope you get a general idea of what we try to do. Look at the kinematics, probability function, correlation, spectra. Once we understand that one, we look at the dynamic of turbulent motion under statistical analysis. OK, so I'll see you Thursday. If you have all your selection of the paper ready, give it to me so I can put them together. Donna, that's all.